I don't need notes for this introduction, because...
You got a lie?
No, you're just okay. You're a legend. And so, David Baugh is like the embodiment of criminal defense in Virginia. And the stories that have been told of him and his escapades are legendary, whether it's a rubber chicken or a fist fight in the hallway.
I forgot about that one.
With a legislator we may have honored a few years ago. But I heard a story about you last night that I'd never heard before, and it was that...
She lied.
You went into private practice initially because you were fired as a prosecutor for calling the judge racist when he was sentencing people.
I didn't call him racist. I just asked why when black people were found guilty, they went to prison, and when white people were found guilty, they got probation.
And speaking truth to justice, even when he's on the other side...
Oh, wait a minute, I tell you what, within a year, that judge died, which I took as a sign of God that I won the argument. And he's still dead.
And all of us and every single client he's ever represented are better off for it.
Yes.
So, the myth, the man, the legend, David Baugh.
Thank you. First, I want to start off with this, by the way. I'm old and semi-retired. If we want to discuss anything that I've written in here and I'm going to talk to you about, call me or email me. And further, I'm going to volunteer Chris. Everything they talked about, everything. No, I'm serious. I have known Chris for 20 years. One thing I'll say about the criminal defense bar, I was sworn in October the 12th, 1975 in Texas. In all that time, I have never asked for help from a criminal defense attorney when they did not do it, ever. Civil lawyers eat their young, but criminal defense attorneys, Marvin, I met, God, how many years ago was that? I mean, seriously, I used to be a prosecutor. And that is one of the benefits of belonging to this organization. This is a big goddamn law firm. So don't hesitate to call and ask for help, no matter who you are. Like I said, if I have a question about an out-of-state subpoena, I'm going to call him. So, first, we're going to talk about a few things before I get into this. One of the best ways in the world to become wealthy is to sell something that nobody else has. The reason diamonds are so goddamn expensive is because they're so rare. In the Commonwealth of Virginia, only 1.6% of felonies go to a jury trial. 1.6%. The criminal justice system in the Commonwealth of Virginia does not have the time to try every felony that wants one. Sometimes when you set, years ago, I used to set juries with Judge Wilkinson. I set juries for Friday morning, and he wouldn't have a calendar in front of him. He'd just write it down. Thursday night, you get an offer from the prosecutor. You got a murder case. Will he accept a plea to littering because he left a body in the street? I mean, seriously. You need, truth to business. Prosecute goes by a drug case. Are you willing to stipulate to drugs? What are you going to give me for it? I'm not going to give you shit. Well, I'm not going to stipulate. You got to bring the chemist into the courtroom, and they're going to put the chemist on the stand, and you're going to go through the dog and pony show. You know, I studied at VCU, and I have it, you know. And I, you know, Mr. Baugh, your questions. You did all this lab report to determine it was heroin? Yes. Did you do any tests to determine that the defendant was in possession? No. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you knew something relevant. Pass the witness. Yes. Never stipulate to anything unless you get something for it. If I don't stipulate, the prosecutor won't like me. He doesn't like you now. You know, so I would suggest you want to get the reputation as a trial lawyer. Secondly, we have an ethical obligation to represent people to the best of our ability. And we have to set fees that compensate us for the use of that. If we set a fee too high, if we set a fee too low, we're screwing it up. I have people call me all the time. What do you charge for a felony? I mean, did you shoot the Pope or did you run over a dog? I mean, what the hell is it? I'm serious. What do you charge for a felony? I'm serious. I got that question all the time, going like, who the hell are you? You know, we are trial lawyers. We make a crap load of money, and we should. Now, first, if you're going to be a productive trial lawyer, you need to set an hourly fee in your own mind. It doesn't have to be written in stone, but there has to be a reasonable hourly fee. What do I pay for rent? How much do I pay my secretary? What do the library, how much do I pay for myself? You take all those figures, total them up, divide them by 25, because nobody works 40 hours a week. We have a lot of dead time. And that's your hourly fee. Now, is it written in stone? No. But you need to make about that much money per hour to intelligently stay in the practice of law. And when you charge less than that, somebody told me that you have lawyers who talk people into pleading guilty. It's the defendant's decision, not yours. And you need to explain to the defendant when they first come in, whether or not you plead guilty, sport, is your, I'm not even going to tell you whether you should or not. It's your decision. You got to give them that power in order to. So set a fee for how much you need to charge an hour, and it should make sense. It should be reasonable. Again, it doesn't have to be written in stone, but for God's sake, write it down somewhere and remember it. That's your target. You have 25 hours a week to make that much money. A year and a half ago, I gave up my office. My fees went down because I don't have to pay rent anymore. David, you make a crap load of money. Why you? Because I don't have to, and I'm ethically bound to charge a reasonable fee. So I have mouth palsy, good, my lip kind of drip. So first, never set a fee in a criminal case over the phone. Divorce lawyers can do that. PI lawyers can do that. You can't do it because your fee is going to determine on how much work you have to do. We are artists. We're not mechanics. We're artists. And you need to find out what is the reasonable defense and how much you're going to take to put it on. So get them in the office and talk about it. One, identify during the first meeting. I'm serious, you can do this. What is the defense going to be? A lot of civil lawyers can't do that. We can, because now, is it going to be exact? No, it's an art. Art doesn't lend itself to exactness. But what's it going to be to pull off the defense that they want? Ensure that the client understands how much work is going to be involved in pulling that shit off. Now, every case doesn't go to a jury, but the client tells me how far they want to go. I'm assuming that every case is going to a jury. In fact, when I set a case for trial, if you are the prosecutor and you don't want to try that case, you got to talk me out of it. Jury trial. I know too many goddamn judges to trust them. And they say, well, this judge is a good judge. You can trust him or her. Now I got 13 jurors. Always take it. If you give up a jury trial, have the prosecutor talk you out of it. And to talk you out of it, they got to give up something, goddammit. You know, I'll set it for, I'll screw, if you can't win the case, screw up the docket. Yes, indeed. Remember to tell the client that they are in charge, and I mean that. Well, should I plead guilty? I don't know, I ain't got to serve the time. Period. Well, what are my odds? I don't know what the odds are. I think you got a good defense, but I can't guarantee it. I think you got a crappy defense. I wouldn't do it. But it's your call. Well, I got to talk to my mother. No, you can't talk to your mother because she ain't got to serve the time. You got to make the decision. Encourage the client to talk to other lawyers. Oh, yes. Every time I set a fee, I say, hey, there are other lawyers out there. I would suggest you talk to other lawyers. However, if the lawyer offers you a fee that sounds too low, don't trust him. If the lawyer if he gives you a guarantee, definitely don't trust him. Yes, you gotta, when you give a fee, you have to warn clients what bad fees are like. All right? So here's a fact pattern for a case. Now they tell you when you do these CLEs, you never tell war stories. Well, we're going to tell goddamn war stories today. This is a real story. Client came in. He was a 19-year-old African-American, returned home. He wasn't a high school graduate. He was a graduate. He'd already graduated. He was taking his girlfriend to the prom. She is a student. While returning home after dropping her off, he was stopped for a defective taillight. Sound familiar? He gave police officers permission to search the car and stuck down between the backrest and the cushion. It was his uncle's car. They found heroin. Stuck down there. And so they charged him with possession of heroin. He tells the police officer, I didn't know the drugs were there. Yeah, right, fat goddamn chance. He has no criminal charge. He's charged with possession of heroin. At the preliminary hearing, his lawyer who represented him, judge certified it because it was under the cushion. Family came and hired me. I'm telling you, this is going to trial. Well, you ought to be able to tell the prosecution what the defense is and they'll dismiss it. Fat goddamn chance. The only way you're going to get a dismissal is to beat them up and take it. Now, how much the fee is, I know how much I need to make an hour. I don't have to spend a lot of money on investigation. Investigation, first, in that case, I can tell you what I did. Give me your fingerprints and give me the DNA. They don't have fingerprints or DNA on the heroin. So I know what they don't have. That's it, it's an easy case. I try the case and I've also two books on my desk. Criminal Offenses and Defenses in Virginia and the code books. So, I read the jury instructions. In order to prove possession, you have to prove actual or constructive possession. Proximity is never enough, and that's in the statute. So, I am going to trial, and proximity is going to be the defense. Voir dire. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, this is a little clicker that makes this work. You know it's a little clicker that it works. I know it's a clicker. Are you in possession of that? No. Are you close to it? Yes. Are you exercising dominion and control over that? No. Now, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, if the government has to prove dominion and control, would you agree that is not dominion? Yeah, I would. Shit, I'm happy as shit. You can serve on the jury. Somebody said, well, if you're close enough to it, I say that's possession. Really? Yes. What would I have to prove to you to convince you you're not in possession? Well, if you showed me this and this, good. Get the hell off the jury. You can't serve. You just shifted the burden. The judge said, well, I'm going to rehabilitate. You understand? No, judge. There are 8 cases in Virginia, and I would suggest you look them up. You cannot rehabilitate with leading questions. But the leading case is a capital case. You cannot rehabilitate with leading questions. Once the juror has committed themselves to the unfavorable answer, that son of a bitch is stuck. Yes. And you need to, excuse me, Honor, I object. You're rehabilitating with leading questions. Oh, no, I wasn't. Yes, you were, Your Honor. Yes, I fight with judges. In fact, remember that one time? What do you call a lawyer with an IQ of 50? Your Honor. So, I've voir dire on possession. My opening statement, I am not in possession. Now, that's a good idea, right? But then you're feeling frisky. So when the police officer takes the stand, I said, "Officer, is it true that you found these drugs down in the cushion of his uncle's car?" Yeah, he said it was his uncle's car. "And did you ever see him exercise dominion and control over it?" And this was a gift from him. "Mr. Ball, where I come from, if you're sitting on it, you're in possession." "Really? Well, why don't you reach down on the witness stand and find the little bag of white powder that I hung in the lunch?" He pulled it up. Got a 7-minute acquittal. What, the judge is going to say anything to you? I've used that trick 3 times. Yes. I'll give you another one. Police officers come in a room. There are 4 guys sitting around a table and a kilo of dope on the table. All right, this is a true case. 3 of the defendants pled guilty. Where's dominion and control? It's not a crime to sit next to drugs. It's not a crime to sit next to somebody else's drugs. The statute says proximity is never enough. And I know from discovery, they ain't got no fingerprints, they ain't got no DNA, and nobody's going to testify. In fact, if somebody at the table does testify, I'm going to impeach them because they're sitting just as close to that dope as my client is. So therefore, I want a jury trial. I trust juries. There's nothing smarter than a goddamn jury. I put this here. This is instruction 2293, Virginia Model Jury Instructions. Actual physical possession means that the substance is found on the person. Constructive possession means that the person has dominion and control over the substance. Mere proximity is not enough. So if they find drugs on the table and your client is, and this is the truth, this was square. The other 3 co-defendants pled guilty. I didn't. And they couldn't convict them because they don't have possession. You want to get the reputation as the attorney who tries juries. The best compliment you can get is when you walk into the courtroom, the prosecutor says, "Oh, shit, it's him." That's the best. By the way, you may have noticed that there are not many of us here. I am African American. I practice in the capital of the Confederacy. I win a lot of goddamn cases. And I'll tell you something else. There are people in this audience who have breasts. They're called women lawyers. I know. Yes. If you get the rep for trying juries, you can scare the shit out of them. A prosecutor can say, "Oh shit, it's her." You want to get that sort of reputation. As I said to this one, by the time I take a case, if it doesn't go to a jury trial, prosecutor's gonna talk me out of it. And I'm not giving up nothing unless they offer a good deal. So, read the statutes. Now, How do you set a fee? Now, I know in the hypo that I gave you, my defense is going to be, there ain't possession. Am I going to suggest to the prosecutor give me a deal? No. Because a prosecutor will tell a cop what to say. I don't trust police. I used to be a prosecutor. I would never trust police. So, no. It's better to trap them. So, therefore, when I take this case, it's going to go to a jury trial. Now, I'm not going to do a whole lot of preparation for it because all I do is file discovery for fingerprints and DNA. I'm setting up my defense of possession in voir dire. I'm setting up my theory of the defense during opening. I'm setting up my theory of the defense during cross. Now, the police officer did say the defendant said he didn't, it wasn't his. That's okay. If the defendant said that, it's fine. If not, I'll ask him to review his notes. Wait a minute, that's not in your notes. You just made that up, didn't you? Objection, who cares? They can't appeal. You know, let them object till the cows come home. I want you, during voir dire, after you get all this, after you come up with a theory for the defense, the next question is, how long is it going to take to put this on? Yes. And you're going to have a jury trial. And it's going to be less than a day. This isn't federal court. I used to be a federal prosecutor, as they said, and I was glamorously fired. And that judge is now dead, which I took as a sign from God that she wanted to take him. So then when I take the case, when I decide to take the case, I can do it. There are three questions I got to ask the defendant. One, if I have the time to represent you, you want the defendant to know that his presence is an inconvenience. If you can pay the fee, that's telling the defendant that it's going to cost an arm and a leg. If I want your case, it's all my choice. If I want your case, then the next question is, if I take your case, what do you expect me to do? I expect you to get me off. That's not what we're talking about. I can't guarantee you I'm going to take you off. I can guarantee you I'm good, but I can't guarantee you I'll guarantee you I'll try my level best. Yes, sir. You got, you got to wait for the microphone because she'll get mad at you and hit you with it.
What is your best practice when the prospective client tells you he or she can only afford your fee up to prelim?
That's good. I tell them that I used to drive a Jaguar. If I went to the dealership and I said, well, I can't afford a Jaguar, he'd say, well, then you can't buy a goddamn Jaguar. If he cannot pay what you need to make an hour in the time it takes you, you can't afford to take that case. You can't. You have to tell him. And I'll tell you what else you got to do. Excuse me. I'm sorry. I hate it. Once I set the fee, and I haven't forgotten your question, I tell them to go speak to other lawyers. I would insist that you talk to other lawyers. However, if the lawyer charges you a fee that sounds too good to be true, don't trust him. If the lawyer says, oh, you can pay me on time, don't trust him. If the lawyer gives you a guarantee, you're getting ripped off. And it's amazing the number of times that clients come back to me and say, that son of a bitch did exactly what you said they'd do. That son of a bitch, I asked him for a guarantee, and he gave it to me. Yes. If they can't afford, if a kid needs an operation to save their life, the family will find the money. Trust me. You'd be amazed at how much they can come up with. Now, wait a minute. I also, because I would like to go to heaven, assuming there is one, I do a lot of pro bono work, too, because it seems to me that when I get to the pearly gates, I got a better chance of getting in. But I do a lot of pro bono work. If it's an interesting case, remember this, every case you take, like, sometimes I do misdemeanors, and I don't charge that much because misdemeanors appearing in general district court is the best advertising in the world. It's better than taking out an ad. You'd be amazed if you go in court on a misdemeanor and you get it dismissed, and as you walk up, you got to do the walk up the center aisle. Can I get your card? Sorry, I got to talk to my client. Play hard to get. Can I get your card? In a minute, I got to go talk to my client. You want to go to general district court, not to make money, to justify your time, but that's the best advertising you can get. And it's free. And you, many times you go into general district court and you leave a prosecutor smoking in the dust. That's the rep you want. And the judges know, oh shit, it's him. If I set this misdemeanor, it's gonna tie up the court for an hour. That's right. I do the, if I got time ahead, I send a letter. I want the chemist brought into general district court. Yes. I want that to happen. It doesn't cost me anything. I have that in the hard drive. I can just spit that out. I have a computer. Yes, sir.
So the client tells you he can afford your fee up to prelim, and the family will find the money somehow or another.
Excuse me, the client can't take
the
my
prospective
fee.
Client tells you he can afford your fee, but only up to prelim in general district court, no. And that the family, he's sure, will be able to find the money somehow or another for the jury trial. How would you handle that?
I never took a case just for the prelim, period. Because if the case is worth, if they want them, if it gets dismissed to prelim, they're going to indict them. I used to be a capital defender. I've had cases dismissed to prelim. They turn around and indict them for capital murder, period. If it's a lot of drugs, they're going to indict them. I'm assuming that any dismissal at prelim ain't a dismissal. It's coming back. Now, I can tell you this. I don't know how much you have to make an hour, but the amount of time, if you have a defense, the amount of time that you take working on that case is less than you think it is, if you look at it seriously. And like I said, you want to get the rep of winning cases. You want to go to trial because no matter how bad the facts are against you, the prosecutor can't afford to try your case. Only 1.6% of felonies go to jury trials in Virginia. You want to be in that 1.6%. You want to have the rep of going in that 1.6%. Now, wait a minute. Not everybody can do it. They can't. I was prepped. When I finished undergrad, I was going to the Yale School of Drama to be an actor. And then I got expelled from college, and I ended up getting my degree from federal court, and I thought, this looks like fun. I could do this shit. Yeah. And the day this is the truth, in Texas, I worked for a lawyer named Jesse Funches. And I remember I passed the bar. It was on a Friday. And I went in and I told Jesse, Mr. Funches, I need off next Thursday. Why? Because I have to go to Austin, Texas to get sworn in because I passed the bar. You can't go. I can't go get sworn in, not next Thursday. Monday morning at 8 o'clock, Judge Peavy, P-E-A-V-Y, is swearing you in his chambers, and at 10 o'clock, you're picking a jury in Texas versus Sturrock. I had been a lawyer 2 hours when I tried my first, well, I know you're being nice. Yes, I won it. I had been a lawyer 8 days when I first tried my first murder. Yes. Not everybody can do it, but there's some talented people in this room. You may not think you are, but you are. And you have more time than they do. And you need to exploit that. So I included in here a contract. I would also suggest that you print this out. I have written contracts in every case. And the reason I have written contracts is it sets what I'm doing. It tells them what I have to do, what I don't have to do, what happens if somebody else hires me. I only have one client. It ain't who pays me the bills. It's if your mama hires me, I only work for you. In fact, if you want me to, I'll lie to your mother. My client is a son of God, and everyone else is a son of a bitch. Yeah. So I would suggest that you copy my contract and you use it. Secondly, and I cannot overemphasize this, you want to get the rep of the lawyer. In every relationship, the one who values it the least is always in control. That goes true for prosecutors. I have a relationship, prosecutor, I value it the least. I am always in control. Remember that. And by the way, if you keep forgetting it, call me. I'll remind you. You don't get the pom-poms, you know, rah, rah, rah. But you know, if you take pom-poms, I'll get some pom-poms out. But you want, you need to share this. It makes you a better lawyer. So the most wonderful thing you get about this is you may be able to tell from my presentation, people who were charged with crimes, I envy them if they can hire me. I do. I'm going like, you know, this, I mean, really, I love this goddamn job. It's better than anything, and there are other lawyers in here I respect, like gray-haired lawyers like Marvin. No, I'm serious. And I want to reemphasize, I have never called a defense attorney and asked for help and didn't get it. And I want you to call me if you have problems and ask for help. I'll help you. How to set a fee. How to investigate. Just 2 books, the jury instruction book and criminal defenses, offenses and defenses in Virginia. That's all you need. Yes, oh, by the way, no matter how good you are, read the effing statute. Always read the statute. Yes, no matter how many times you've done it, read the goddamn statute. And let the client see you reading it. It would be nice to charge every client a fee that they can afford. However, you can't do it. I'm sorry, you can't. You can't do it. I would like to be able to help every cripple kid. I can't do it. I can't do it. And when I tell them why I'm charging them that much money, and more importantly, don't trust lawyers who charge you less. Lawyers will try to undercut. And they'll try to undercut by charging fees that are really violations of the rules of conduct. If a lawyer charges too low a fee, are they charging a fee to get you to pay them some money, or are they charging you a fee because that's what they need to represent you? You can't do it. Now, some lawyers have less overhead and have lower hourly fees. Like I said, I just closed my office 2 years ago, and I now work out of my house. I don't pay rent. I don't have a secretary. I mean, you don't need one anymore if you got a laptop, you can work. So, and I gotta reemphasize this, I've never asked for help from another criminal trial lawyer and not received it. Because we're not a profession, we're a clique. We are. We are, we know each other. We're in the same boat, and I will always help. So, what you have to do, and I'm gonna leave you with only a couple of points. One, determine your hourly fee. Determine how much you have to make before you declare bankruptcy. Number two, never set a fee over the phone. Invite the client in, talk to them, interview them, ask them questions, assume that they're lying, make them justify their telling the truth to you, and tell them, if you lie to me, your ass is gonna fall off. Trust me, if you lie to me and we're going to trial, I'm gonna go, your ass fell off. Is that your ass? That's not mine. Yes. You need to tell me the truth, because if you tell me the bad stuff, I can probably get around it. Oh, and how do you get around it? Voir dire. The defendant confessed. He told the officer that he did this. But now, he's going to say he was tricked into that. Are there any of you who would automatically assume that if the defendant confessed, he was telling the truth? Yeah, I would. Good. You can't serve on the goddamn jury. Get the off. Everything bad about your case, you bring out in voir dire. I tried a case in, what was that county? One of those jurisdictions that nobody wants to go to. The first time we tried the case, the judge brought in 30, oh, it was involving a assault on a child. They brought in, what, 36 jurors? I ran out of jurors. Next time, they did it with 50 jurors. I ran out of jurors. Next time, they got 100. I was able to pick a jury. And the defendant got 3 years. Which, prosecutor said, I beat you. I said, yeah, right, 3 years. That's fine. That's right. I mean, you can have a prosecutor call you all kinds of things, but never have a prosecutor say you're easy. You know, it's like prom night, I'm easy. Yeah. Now, you want to, what I'm trying to tell you is that I'll help you any way I can. You have the most fortunate job in the world. There are people around this room who are good at what they do. Rely on them, ask for them, and you and I need to talk. I'm going to leave you my, you and I are going to talk, I'm going to give you my card. Any questions about any new business, any motions on the floor? Good, I covered everything well. Have I talked long enough? Because I'm tired of me. I'm tired of listening to me.
David, talk about flat fees and the client leaves and how you deal with them.
There are no flat fees.
Well, you need to explain that.
Well, I need to explain.
Explain how people, when they set fees and they don't go all the way in the case because a client might go to another lawyer, how you deal with that issue.
Because I'm used to that. When that, during that first interview with the client, I tell that client, you should get other, but if they give you a flat fee, don't trust them. If you trust them, you're an idiot. If a lawyer says, I'll charge $10,000 to rep, no, you can't do it. And if you do it, you're an idiot. So that's how I deal with flat fees. We are artists. We can't deal in flat fees. I mean, I believe that. We are artists. You're an artist, and I know it because I've tried cases against you. Yes, We are artists. We should be arrogant about it. So I think that I hope you, when you do your evaluations, like I said, we have never discussed setting a fee in law school or in a CLE. We need to talk about that. We need to get used to helping each other. Because if you take a case without charging enough money, you are being unethical. Yes, yes, sir.
So, to follow up, although I'm not in private practice, I once was, and I struggled with all of these things. You're charging an hourly fee. I assume you're collecting some upfront as a deposit for your trust account?
Charging all upfront. I'm collecting in my trust account. And if you look at my contract, I don't take it out per hour. I take it because whoever wrote that for the state bar is an idiot or a civil lawyer. My contract says when I make an appearance in court and I get locked to your hip, I've earned a quarter of the fee. The first time I make an appearance in court, I've earned a half of the plea. You know, I've set it up in increments. And after I do this, I take out that much of the fee. Criminal lawyers cannot work by the hour. We can't. It's impossible. If we did, I mean, theoretically, this is the truth. Unlike other lawyers, we spend time thinking about the case over dinner. Theoretically, we're entitled to a bill for that. I'm serious. We're artists. You know, we don't lend ourselves to being efficient. I always say that, you know, Michelangelo could have done the Sistine Chapel in a day if he had a roller, but it ain't the same. We're artists. So, I'm sorry, what's wrong? Am I talking too much? Oh, okay.
So what factors do you keep in mind when you're talking, when you're thinking about setting a fee? So for myself, I've got some things that if the client mentions in the meeting, that's an automatic increase, such as if they start talking about the victim having a mental illness. That's for me a trigger. If there's a dog, that's an additional percentage increase.
Part of the artistry of what we do is you got to figure out how much is it going to take to convince a jury that that's a factor and have it. The victim has mental illness. Well, you issue a subpoena and you get their psychic records. You have the right to put on evidence in your defense. Yes, you do that. First, when you talk to the client, figure out, you know, what do you base that on? What hospital do they go to? Well, I don't know. I can't give you the fee right now because I got to find out. But yes, you have to do that. It's also, you can suggest it during a trial without having any evidence of it. You can do that. Even if you can't prove that, if you're willing to go to trial, you are in control. You can't be afraid of going to trial. You want to go to trial. You want the prosecutor to talk you out of going to trial. It's hard, because see, as defense attorneys, we've always been taught we need to worry about the prosecutor zeroing on us. No. No, when we set a trial for a jury, we are in control. Yes, you want the prosecutor, as I said, to talk you out of a jury. Yes, and when you talk you out of a jury, you gotta talk you out of a jury, you gotta talk you out of experts, you gotta talk you out of lab reports. Yes, everything has to go to trial. Like I said, I can do that because I used to be a prosecutor, yes.
As an artist working at home, where do you meet your prospective clients for the initial consultation?
My living room.
Your living room?
Yes. Because I'm older and I tell them I'm semi-retired and you can come to my living room. Yep. In fact, I have one set for tomorrow. We meet at the dining room. Yeah.
Yep. Thank you.
No, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, what, I don't look professional? I mean, really, I don't look professional now. It's not a problem. If it bothers them to meet in your living room, screw them. Yeah. They have to convince me to represent them. Because if I represent them, they have a better chance of winning than if someone else represents them. I know that. Like I said, someone who can afford me, I envy them. I love them. Yes. So if you practice out, do you practice out of your house?
No, but I am looking into the future, and I know that, or as I recall, the Supreme Court has a requirement that one must have an office address. I'm not sure that I can use my home address when and if I do retire.
Well, I'll give you a business card that lists my home address. Yes. And I have, the only thing is I have an office phone that goes to my answering service. I have a private line, and I have, yes, I can do that. And I have an email address. Yeah, I have an address, and I have a cell phone number, and I have an office number. People call me, they get my answering service. My answering service emails me a call telling me they just called me. And I call them back. Nowadays, with internet, my laptop's over there. I may have told you this, but I'm getting old. When I became a lawyer in 1975, and I was going to go into private practice, did I tell you that already? To open an office, I needed between $4,000 and $5,000 to buy books. Now the shit's free. No. If you're a member of the Virginia Bar, you have free access. That'll do a word search. By the way, remember shepherdizing cases? You're old enough to remember. Nowadays, you remember shepherdizing cases? Checking to see if the opinions are still valid? And you had to go look through all those silly-ass red books? Now you hit the shepherd's button, and it's done automatically. You know, the good old days suck. Yeah, I mean, there are no good old days. So, no, you can do this. And more importantly, there are lawyers who want you to do it and are willing to help you. And when I say help you, it's not only tell you how to do it, but when you get despondent and you say this shit can't be done, we'll be cheerleaders for you. Like, I'll wear an A-line skirt and get some pom-poms, and I mean, I can do this. It's kind of scary, but yeah, trust me, it's only 1.6% of criminal felonies go to a jury trial. That's like finding a diamond. The rarity of it makes it expensive. Ooh. You don't look convinced, but you and I will talk. Any motions on the floor? Any new business? Have I talked enough? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, sir. I know, I used to be a prosecutor too.
Well, no, it's not. when you set this hourly rate in your head, I know, in your head, you know, you can set that based off your overheads and your mortgage. Where does profit fit into that for you in terms of reasonableness?
That's right up there with it. It's a factor I put in there. I figure I ought to make about 20 to 30% profit.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I have to afford. I enjoy practicing law. One of the good things I enjoy about practicing law is driving my sports car. And driving. Oh, did I tell you about the sports car and the SUV? Yes.
Is that the Jaguar?
I enjoy. Huh?
Is that the Jaguar?
No. I got
rid
of
the
Jaguar.
Okay.
I got rid of the Jaguar. I have an SUV. I have a Nissan SUV that belongs to the corporation.
Yeah.
And I have a 2003 Honda S2000 six-speed convertible. God, I envy me. I hope I can be. I hope. No, I do. I hope I can be when I grow up. Yeah. When I say estimate all your expenses, you put in profit. Yes, you have to put in profit because profit is an expense for undetermined things. I mean, when I set a fee, when I put in my cost, we don't count Wheaties. We don't count, a gallon of milk. How much money do I need to live? Yes, that's in there. Yes, how much money do I need to live and to practice law? So that's in there. Yes, how much money I need to pay for that car? Yes. For instance, right now I'm semi-retired. I have 20 suits I don't know what to do with. No, I'm done. I have 20 suits, and I don't know what to do with them. I may need them one day. Who knows? But it's an enviable position. I want you, and by the way, my phone number is, my email address is up here, and you can find my phone number. Call me and tell me, David, I'm estimating what my hourly fee should be. Help me figure it out. And remember, it isn't just whatever you want it to be. It's low enough to be competitive and high enough to cover your expenses. It isn't a number you just make up. And you will call me and we will discuss this. Oh, I thought she was going to come here and hit me because I did something wrong. All right, any motions on the floor? Any new business? I have to say this too. I first got arrested when I was 16 years old during the Nashville sit-ins. You people are my brothers and sisters. I feel closer to you than any other people in the world. We are common in our purpose. We have that in common. And I thank each of you for doing what you do and hope I can make it easier for you. Mic drop.
So Brian and I just want to thank everybody for coming, including the people on Zoom. I also just want to remind everybody that you do not have to be on the board to join committees in VACDL. And we have some pretty active committees coming up this year. Like Rob said, our entire General Assembly is changing over in November. So it's going to be a really big year for legislative advocacy. Lee Smallwood is in charge of our legislative committee. Dave Anderson is in charge of our Indigent Defense Committee. We're going to be working on raising those court-appointed fees. We're also going to be looking into trying to get involved in the reappointment of judges and the appointment of judges, evaluating those and trying to take positions. So if you're interested in seeing change, if you want to get involved, the committees are a great way to do that. So I encourage everybody, reach out to me, and I'm happy to connect you. You want to say anything as CLA chair?
Thank you all very much.
Okay, everybody have a good weekend. Thanks a lot, guys. Yeah.